Hi guys, my name's Theo. I'm Director of Training at Jellyfish. I've been about 3 years, I guess, training various different analytical products at Jellyfish. My previous role to this, I was Head of Analytics at iProspect. I was based in Mumbai. When Google Analytics Premium became resellable, I moved over, which is what now called Analytics 360, part of the Google Marketing Platform.
Thanks, Theo. So without further ado, let's get started. We're going to start with a quick introduction to AnswerDAO as it does. And look at that, we've met our 100-person target already. So AnswerDAO is essentially a clean room as a platform, and it is used to get user-level insights to campaign reporting on media. So Google Media, but also joining that with our first-party data. So this concept of a clean room is important, and I'll go on in a moment to discuss why that is important. It allows us to query this user-level data from our ad impressions and ad clicks in a privacy-safe way. It contains Google Ads data, YouTube data, DV360 and Campaign Manager data. By virtue of the fact that we've got Campaign Manager, we've got Search Ads data in there as well. In addition, we can bring in our first-party data. So that's our website and our CRM data and join it all up. This concept of it being privacy-safe is very important for reasons we will move on to discuss. And it's privacy-safe in that the results are output in aggregate. So when we return, when we do a query and it returns results in a row, there's no more, there's always more than 50 users in that output. And so that way we're not actually getting at the individual user data. It is superior to the data transfer files as a solution, first and foremost, because the data available in the data transfer files is changing and has changed in some regions already in terms of the identifiers that are available. So the data transfer files, once upon a time, contained a double-click ID, an identifier that we could use to do user-level analysis. That is no more. And as such, Google needed a solution that could provide this user-level insight, but also keep customers happy and be compliant with legal regulations, and in fact, go over and above requirements in some instances, to set a benchmark for the industry for thinking about user analysis in a more privacy-safe way. I'm just going to use my pointer here as well. Another important point to note is that we've got the first ever access to the Google ID. That's the Google account identifier. Now, it is behind a veil or behind a curtain, as you will come to understand throughout the session, but it is there all the same, and we can query it in aggregate. And that means that we have an identifier, you know, for Google Ads and YouTube based on the Google account that we can query and even look at Google audience data as well. To explain what the data transfer is, for those of you that maybe don't come from a media background, they are files that we can export from Campaign Manager that allow us access to raw event level data about our media. It's used for campaign reporting. So as I mentioned, changes have occurred in the industry that have led us to this point. And it led us to need to think about user-level analysis as marketers in a different way. Visibility. So we have changes happening in the browsers from Chrome, Firefox, Safari, and in the operating systems as well. That means we need to think about a future-proof solution for ad measurement and ad attribution, because in the coming years, and if not in some browsers already, there will be an issue with third-party tracking cookies. And so we need to think about a future-proof solution. And as I mentioned, the data transfer files that media analysts, maybe media planners, would have used historically to do in-depth analysis to plan future campaigns no longer have that useful ID in them. So we need to use Ads Data Hub for that. There have been changes in the past couple of years as well, both in Europe and in the US, in the law around user data. So taking GDPR and CCPA as examples there. So that's kind of what's changed in the last couple of years, leading us up to a greater expectation of user privacy, both from the customers and what's going to be done with their data, but also advertisers are very aware that that's how things are moving and want to be compliant and develop solutions and measurement solutions and attribution solutions that are compliant and go above and beyond there. So our benchmark is higher. So what can it do? What can Ad Data Hub do? It allows us to join a first-party business data and audience data together. So when we talk about first-party data, we're talking about their data that you own as an organization or that your client owns if you're an agency or a partner. And that could be website, CRM data, and so on. And then audience data, so that's perhaps the audiences that we're targeting in DV360 or maybe Google audiences that we're using to target our media as well. It allows us to do that in a privacy-safe way at a user level, outputting an aggregate. Further to that, it enables us to do reach and frequency reporting. Yes, that's something that we could do before, but on a greater timescale. So in the campaign manager interface, we are limited to 93 days, whereas with Ad Data Hub, we can look back over 13 months. And that's particularly important for any industries or any advertisers with a longer buying cycle. In addition to that, we get more granular data. So more granular data in terms of viewability metrics, in terms of video engagement metrics as well. And it enables us, as was mentioned up here, to do a cross-environment analysis because we have Google IDs, DoubleClick IDs, and mobile device IDs all in one space. And if somebody can help us out with the entry beats there, please, Ben, that'd be much appreciated. I agree with you, Rochelle. It's driving me bonkers, losing my train of thought. Okay, so we've talked about reach and frequency, we've talked about viewability and video engagement metrics, and then finally I wanted to talk about the YouTube campaign reporting as well. So we have the ability to look at cross-device usage and device exposure to ads on YouTube using the Google account ID. So how does it work? We can build a query, a SQL query, and in Google BigQuery, and that is done through a language, as I mentioned, SQL, a database language, something that would be familiar to database administrators or business analysts as well. We then run that query and in the Ads Data Hub sandbox. So Ads Data Hub is a platform itself. We log in there. There's a sandbox environment, a testing environment with about a month's worth of data that we can play around with and run queries against. And this is the best practice because it allows us to test the boundaries in a way. Not that I'm suggesting that we should be trying to manipulate the system at all, but understand how the tool works, shall we say, and where we might hit privacy restrictions and redactions in terms of the outputs of our query. Theo will explain more about that when we do an example demo later. So we've used the sandbox environment. That enables us then to run the query on our own Ad Data Hub instance via the UI, so logging into the platform, or via an API. And from there, then, the privacy checks occur. So Google runs these privacy checks in the background before it returns the results out to our BigQuery project. And don't worry, for those that have questions in the chat box, we will pause for questions in just a bit. So privacy checks occur. And at this point, I think it's worthwhile mentioning as well that it's not just Google media data, so your ad impressions, your ad clicks that you've run through the Google systems. You can join your first-party data and you have access to Google proprietary data as well. These aggregated results are returned to your BigQuery project. So BigQuery is a Google Cloud Platform tool, essentially a data warehouse, and allows us to do, well, if we're coming from an analytics background, raw hit level analysis of the data. And in this instance, that's where our Ads Data Hub query is output to. So if you will, it's behind the veil or behind a curtain. We can't actually see it in the Ads Data Hub interface. We're querying against something, and then the output is put into our own cloud project. So that can be quite tricky for those that are getting used to working with Ads Data Hub for the first time. That can be a common difference if you're used to working with Google BigQuery. From there, best practice would be to put those results into some more digestible formats for the rest of your organization to look at. So this is only part of the work. Then we need to tell the story. We need to build a dashboard in whatever dashboarding tool we're using, whether it be Data Studio or otherwise, to spread those insights out to the rest of the organization. It's not meant to be read from the Ads Data Hub interface, which brings me on to talking about the various stakeholders involved in these projects. What we've talked about so far is not necessarily the bread and butter and the day-to-day of any marketer. In our organization, these tasks are run by data science, data engineers, and our media planning team. In the client organizations that we've been working with, we've seen the technical media analysts also upskill on this, media planners, and even in-house trade desks as well, with some training and support. So it's quite a varied discipline that's required in terms of SQL skills, knowledge of the media, and those that excel, obviously, with a good understanding of data science and data engineering. All right, so before we move on to talk about use cases there, I think that has been done. And we'll come to those questions in the chat in just a moment. So a couple of client success stories, if you will. We can't go into too much detail or give a name, unfortunately, at the moment, but we are working on some public-facing case studies that will be shared shortly as well. The first one is audience overlap analysis. So this was a global software company, a client of ours, that came to us for Azure Hub onboarding, set up an onboarding and subsequently consulting around the data. And what they wanted to achieve here was to understand the overlap between the different audiences that they're targeting in DV360, because the audiences weren't mutually exclusive. So what we helped them to do was extract the floodlight variables that made up the audiences, so the differences in the audiences, so things like the number of impressions and the content that the audience is looking at, into a matrix so that we could see the attributes. This helped us to identify potential cross-sell opportunities across the audiences, and ultimately where the value add was in terms of doing this in Ads Data Hub was that it was user level insight. So it was a user level insight because we were able to look at prominent identifier. The impact, as you'll see down here, was the ability to understand where the audiences intersect and thus the ability to reduce waste campaign impressions. So with the same media budget, we were able to reduce the audience overlap and save on media spend. Same clients again, building from that, when we had done the audience overlap, the next logical question was, how frequently are some of those audiences being targeted and can we optimize that further? So can we understand how often they're being shown ads and find the sweet spot there? So we looked at frequency distribution across media types. Again, if we were to have done this in Campaign Manager, we would have been restricted to 93 days, whereas in Ads Data Hub, you have this 13-month period of data. And that was quite beneficial in this instance because the company, being a global software company, sells something that might not be bought too frequently, as in it's not a high turnover or short buying cycle, quite a long consideration cycle. So that longer period of time was particularly relevant. We were able to recommend frequency capping for certain campaigns and for certain what we deem then sub-strategic groups to reduce wasted impressions. 20% increase in reach and an increase in conversion rate for the same media spend. And the final use case, this is another client of ours working in consumer finance. And this one involved mapping different user journeys. So we mapped user journeys between media touch points for the different products. I'm going to need my pointer for this one. So over on this side here, you'll see 7 different conversion journeys for 7 different products. And this is the initial journey. This is the next journey that was taken subsequent to completing, let's say it was a credit card application and converting. And then the users went on to complete a car loan application. You can see here the 65% overlap in terms of people who completed a credit card application journey and then subsequently went on to complete a car loan application journey. And that is insightful for us because we can understand the interplay and the upsell opportunities and where spending on one product might have implications on sales for another. So that's the long story short there. And as you can see, some other useful insights, 18% of map journeys started 1 week prior to conversion. So what's the difference versus GMP and being able to do an analysis in Campaign Manager here? Well, in Campaign Manager, we are limited in past conversion measurements. So we cannot combine or stitch together multiple paths to conversion. So that was why we needed to do this in Ads Data Hub. So that's just a little bit about use cases, what our clients are using it for. We're going to now move into actually talking about writing a query. And I wanted to share with you all that this is using a language called SQL. So some of you might be new to that, don't freak out. this is just showing you what the platform can do for those that are more technically minded. As I mentioned, there's a whole host of roles that are required to use this platform and deliver insights from data planners to analysts, whether they be web analysts with SQL skills or data science and data engineering, and then finally turning that output into a story, data storytellers, or those with experience in data visualization. So here's a quick insight from Theo. Sorry, Theo, I'll unmute you.
Hi guys, just to start with, I just wanted to discuss the importance of using temporary tables to query in Ads Data Hub. So temporary tables are persistent for 72 hours. And the reason why we want to use temporary tables is because we want to minimize querying the underlying data within ADH. So with ADH, what happens is because it's a clean room, it's protecting user privacy. So querying the same data set too closely or the underlying data set too closely means that we may be able to identify individual users, which will then cause privacy flags. So to not do this accidentally, we want to minimize our number of times we need to query that underlying data set, therefore not getting privacy flags on our data, which will restrict our access to that data in a future, for future use. So one of the ways to do that is a temporary table. They're persistent for 72 hours, and they are it only resides in the ADH or the Google BigQuery instance within ADH. So you don't then, it's not outputted, and therefore you can do manipulation of your data. And this is known as staging. So when you write queries, one query after the other, manipulating the data as you go using a temporary table is known as staging. And the idea is you can then do all of your querying, manipulation of the data and analysis within ADH, which has its benefits because ADH is actually free to query. So there's no cost there. And then we just output the results that we need in aggregate in Google BigQuery, which is our own instance, which we will pay for. Okay, so this is a quick example of a temporary table. We say just create table. Temporary table is an alias here. We use our select from clause within SQL. I just use the activities events table. Activities events table is our conversion table in Campaign Manager. So it has all our conversion information in there. And then I've used a simple aggregate function to count the user IDs to make sure that I'm outputting more than 50 user IDs per row. In this case, it's just going to be one row. And then to access the data from the temporary table, we need to use this prefix, TMP, and it is case sensitive. It needs to be lowercase, TMP dot, and then the name of the table that we're going to use. So one of the other points I want to point out at this point is if we're going to use ADH, there is a table schema available within ADH. So this table schema will basically tell us all of the details about the fields, the tables that we're going to use in ADH, as well as all the descriptions. And this is not available within the platform. Although there is a table schema, the descriptions aren't there to tell us the information. The reason why we want to do this is because we need to look at the different column headers in the fields and how they reside differently to what we know within the Google Marketing Platform. So the data might not be in the same format as it is in the Google Marketing Platform. So I'm just going to do a in-platform demo and walk through some of the steps of ADH, and so you can have a look and feel for the platform. So I'm just going to share my screen. Okay. So this is the ADH platform. And as you can see, there is three tabs on the left-hand side. And we have queries, jobs, and audiences, and then some settings and then support. And we have all the queries that have been writing over that have been written before. And it's a little bit more simple than Google BigQuery. Google BigQuery has a little bit more options available to you. You can also see there's the account over here, which is what our account of ADH is. And that's our account number. Now, just to go through the different tabs, the queries is where if we create a query, it will reside in this query list. The jobs is if we're going to run a query, that would be a job. And then the audiences is we can actually run a query to build an audience and access that audience directly within the Google Marketing Platform. So we can actually action our query insights directly in the Google Marketing Platform by building audiences directly in ADH. This is a very new beta feature, which has actually only appeared today in this account. But we're going to have a look at today at just writing a simple query. So I'm going to hit create query over here. So to build an audience, you can build an audience from just writing a blank query over here. And on the left-hand side we're going to use today is looking at the analysis. Now, there is a load of templates available for you to create your analysis. But one thing to note is they use this with clause or common table expression with clause. And what we want to do, these queries were written at the beginning of ADH, inception of ADH, and it's been there's a lot of changes since then, and it's best practice now to use temporary tables. So what you want to do, if you are going to use some of these template queries, which are perfectly fine, you may want to change some of the syntax out to use temporary tables. So what we're going to do is we're just going to build a quick example of a temporary table and show you the sort of interface and how to do that. So I'm just going to click create a blank query. The first thing you need to do is just name your query. So I'm just going to put my first query. Well, it's my 10,000th query, really, but it's my first query. So the name of this one. And what we're going to do then, so we've got here is your SQL editor. So we can write our SQL in here. We can even lift in some SQL using the query templates. And what I want to show you to start off with is these parameters and table schemas. So the table schema is just like the table schema on the web, and we'll send a link out in the email as well. The table schema is over here, and it doesn't tell you that much information about each individual table, except for the name of the table and the fields that reside into it. You can input, for example, if I click this button here, it will copy the field name into the editor. And then we've got parameters. Now, parameters are used to scale our query. So what we can do is insert variables into our SQL by adding parameters. And we'll have I'll show you that in our query that we're going to look at. And then we have this filtered row summary. And filtered row summary allows us to know how many impressions or clicks or users that are getting dropped from our results due to the privacy restrictions. So for example, if I aggregate my results and I have certain rows which are slightly less than 50 users, they're going to get dropped from my results. And so therefore I can use this filtered row summary to find out how many users I'm losing. So you can simply add a rule here, you type in something like users, and then you would then sum this up. And this would add a row into your results to tell you how much you've lost. So let's write our query. So I'm just going to write create table. This is how we create a temporary table. We use this in the create table. And then we need to give the table its alias. So I'm just going to call mine temporary underscore table. And then we say as. And don't worry, we're just going to do a very, very basic query, just a select from clause and a where clause, nothing too complicated. We're going to use a user ID because most of the time we're going to use user ID because obviously we have access to the user IDs in ADH and we won't have access to them in DT files. So this is probably one of the main reasons why we would be using ADH. So we can put user ID. I'm also going to say from, and the table I'm going to use is the activities table. So that is campaign manager, data transfer file, activities. Now, you may have noticed that this table is within the table schemas. Just to let you know, this table has already been deprecated. Even though the product is quite new, we no longer use the activities table. What we need to use is the activities underscore events table. So don't be put out by that, because a lot of the template queries are still using the old version, which is deprecated. So do be aware of that. So just in case if you didn't catch it, the activities table is your conversion table. So it has all your conversions in there. And this is your conversions in Campaign Manager. So what we're going to do is we're going to use the where clause to select a specific conversion. And I'm going to show you the parameters. So I'm going to say where events dot activity underscore ID. And I'm going to say in, and then I'm going to say at. And this is how we add in a parameter, use this at symbol. And then you can call it what you like. I'm going to call mine act for activity underscore ID. And I'm going to close my brackets this way. So then once we've done this, we'll just close the brackets for the query. To finish this off, I need to then add, as you can see here, the query validator saying act ID not found. We need to add a parameter here so we can insert our parameter over here. So we simply put act ID. And then we select the data type this is going to be, and it's going to be an integer in this case. Now, if I ran this query, as you can see, it says your query has good syntax and passed initial privacy checks. You may have noticed, well, we've just selected user IDs, which is individual. But this is because it's a temporary table, so I'm not actually going to output this anywhere. This is going to still, if I run this, this query is going to still create a table that resides in ADH. So there's no problems with privacy checks. So we can carry on writing as many queries as we like, using the data from our activities table, manipulating that data to do our analysis. And that's what you might have to do with like pathway analysis. You might need to join your impressions table, your clicks table with your activities table to do that. So now to access the data from the temporary table, or to output it to our own instance of BigQuery, we simply put select from clause over here, and we're going to say select, and we have to put it in aggregate format, so I'm going to say select count, which is an aggregate function, and then I'm going to say from, and then we use the syntax TMP lowercase, which is the prefix for your temporary table, and then that's the table name, so I'm just going to copy and paste it in here to make sure we have consistency. Count user underscore ID, made a mistake there. There we go. And so that is our temporary table. So let's just run, save that and give it a run. Now, when we run it, this is the key thing you need to remember. Okay. The key thing is add data from, it says Jellyfish test. Now you want to click here and you want to change this to sandbox mode. And this is the only way you can do it. There's no way of defaulting to the sandbox mode. There is an API, so you can run queries using the API, but if you're doing it within the UI, you need to remember, put this to the sandbox mode. You always want to try your query in sandbox mode first, This where the reason being is because when it goes through the privacy checks, it takes a lot longer to run. And if you make any mistakes, then you're at risk of querying the underlying data multiple times. So run it through a sandbox, see if it's coming out correctly. And then once you've finished, then you can actually run it against your own data. The BigQuery project and the data set you have here is whatever you've linked your ADH instance to. So I can't actually change this because of the linking is already done. So all I can do is give my table a name, and this will create a table within BigQuery. Okay, so I'm gonna call my table TFH for my initials. I'm gonna call it table. And then we need to do change the date range. So one thing to know, if we are using the sandbox mode, we will need to change the date range because sandbox only has dates between August and September 2018. So I'm just gonna take, I usually take the full date range because it's not actually that much data, and just to make sure my query is gonna work. And then you have to then input at the bottom your activity ID. And the great thing about this, or using a parameter, is you can change it depending on what tool you're using, so what ads data, where you're getting your ads data from. So for example, the activity ID within the sandbox is 0 to 100, where normally an activity ID in campaign manager will be like a 7-8 digit number. Okay, so I'm just gonna put 50 in there, and then you just run your job. So this is gonna run a job, and this will take the time to run, and you'll get a little pop-up message if you're using Chrome saying when your job has run. So we're going to come back to the presentation. So a few query tips when writing. One thing to always remember is you can scale queries by setting parameters. This is really useful, especially if you're going to run your query in sandbox mode, because then you can use the sandbox mode activity IDs or the campaign IDs, and then you can change it when you run your query in your own, against your own data. Always use temporary tables. This can help you manipulate the data within ADH without having to query all the time the underlying data. You just query it once, and then you keep querying that temporary table. And always run your query in the sandbox mode first. This way you can see if it's correct, it's coming out, it's resulting how you need it to come in BigQuery. And then if it's working, you can then go back and run it against your own data. Some other things to take into consideration is if you are doing things like audits and things like that, and you have a lot of people querying ADH, try to range the date range that you're going to query your own data with. So if you're doing like an audit, don't everyone query on June, because sometimes you might run into those privacy restrictions. So
we have a quick question for you, Theo. Just at the right time, and it's actually related to what we were just talking about. This, the last one in the chat from Michael regarding when we're creating that temporary table, and we've done that, can we remove the top create section of the query for future runs?
Yes. So when you created your temporary table, what that means is it's in ADH for 72 hours. So all you need to do if you want to run that table again is you say select star, and then you just say from TMP dot name of that table. If you want to change the table, the best thing to do is probably to rewrite the first initial one. So what you can do is you might want to say select all the fields. Well, most of the time you select the fields that you're looking for in, let's say from the activity table, the impressions tables, and the clicks table into a temporary table. And then from there, you have everything that you need to then start manipulating. Yeah, and then you won't need to query the underlying data set again.
Perfect. A couple more questions here. I'm going to start up at the top and then come back down to the last one there from Nandan. So we had one further up around, let's see, to share the schema. There's one from Ali regarding learning SQL. So that one is, well, without over self-promoting, we do have a training course on BigQuery and SQL, a one-day course where you can learn that. There's also lots of other free resources out there. It's strongly recommended if you're coming from a media background to spend time learning that language, because even if you are going to maybe just get familiar with it using the templates, you'll still need to learn to adapt those, and to get really proficient at it and do meaningful analysis, you will need to get comfortable using that database language. So there are courses available. As Hannah mentioned in the chat earlier, we're offering a 50% discount on our scheduled courses in the new year. But there are also other resources out there that you can use to learn that. And we are looking at same version of SQL that's used in BigQuery. standard SQL. Okay, and Ali Knight's question about using, enabling you to use ads to help more effectively. We actually have a couple of slides on that at the end, so we're going to hold the full answer to that until the end.
Dan Robertson had one. If we're using data transfer today, will back historical data populate once we transition to ADH? ADH won't be populating back data, so therefore it's in your interest to get up and running on ADH as soon as possible, especially if you're using DT files. He also put, will ADH help solve for cross-device? Yes, it within reason. So there is a certain amount of cross-device capability because we have receptable device IDs coming into our tables. However, you can't do things like cross-device, cross-platform necessarily. So, it depends on the user IDs that are available. And if we have a common resettable device ID that's available, you can. So it does help solve for cross-device, but in terms of beyond what the capability of GMP has, it's not going to be greatly different in terms of that, the capability there.
We'll talk about cross-device in a couple of slides, Dan, where we talk about the different identifiers across the different platforms. So we're going to come to that one, but essentially we've got the Google ID, which is Google Account ID, the double click ID, which you're used to, and the device ID, and then any first party IDs as well. And as Theo said, it's the data starts collecting from the point of onboarding and when you start linking your media accounts to add data hub. We had one there from Nandan. Do you know if the sandbox access is free to all? It should be. I believe you might need an Ads Data Hub instance though to access it.
Yeah, Ads Data Hub itself is free, and querying within Ads Data Hub is free, but you have to get that set up when linked to your data. And once you get that set up, then you will be able to use the sandbox access. It's not access to all per se. If you're just starting out, you need to have access to ads and ADH instance.
Okay, I think that's it. I think we managed to get through all of the questions there. There will be another opportunity for questions at the very end, in the next 10 or so minutes. But if we've missed anybody's question in the long chat stream, do please bump it back up. Okay, I just had to mute as a siren went past the window. Okay, learning Ads Data Hub. So this is where we talk about our experience, you know, working with colleagues internally and seeing their journey and our own journeys to learning about Ads Data Hub and also working with clients and their partners in upskilling and Ads Data Hub and the various different roles that we've been exposed to and see upskill from a media background or from an analyst or analytics background, and indeed from a data science background as well. So if you are still with us and want to embark on learning about Ads Data Hub, here are some tips for you as to things you should consider in that journey. So first of all, get access to the sandbox if your organization has Ads Data Hub or your client has it, and start running queries in the sandbox environment, as Theo said, because that is the safe way to do it so that we don't incur privacy restrictions. So, you know, you'll get notifications if the query that you ran would have incurred privacy restrictions, so you can learn safely in that sandbox. And when you go to run queries in your own environment, you'll be less inclined to encounter redactions or indeed restrictions on access to the underlying data for a period of time if Google flagged the account. So that's why it's a better environment than your own instance. As we mentioned, and as we saw in some of the questions, SQL is a key component of this. So being able to write SQL queries comfortably. Again, that's not necessarily something that everybody will do. Maybe your role is to understand the context of the data, what it can do, and what to ask for, and then what should be built into the visuals in the dashboards and fed back into the media plan. We do have a course, as I mentioned, on both Agile Hub and on BigQuery and SQL, but this is an important point that we're going to delve into a little bit more before the end, which is understanding the underlying data schema, so understanding the platform and the different user IDs that are available. And don't over-engineer. So if you have a good understanding of what Campaign Manager can do, what GMP can do already, you'll be less likely to come up with projects for Agile Hub that can be done already in perhaps a more simple way in Campaign Manager. So try not to over-engineer, understand what the reporting can give you, and then progress to Agile Hub if you need it for a client solution or for your own user level reporting. Remember, that's the difference there, the user level insight. So just finishing up on that last point there around the data structure then. When we're talking about that, we're talking about the different Google platforms that we've got data for in Ads Data Hub. So it's Google Ads, GMP, so DV360 Campaign Manager and Search Ads, and YouTube data. In accordance or in conjunction with our own first-party data and proprietary Google data. So if we understand what these platforms do, we'll better understand the schema and the structure of the data and how they're used, and therefore what kinds of fields we should be querying, what we're looking for. So as I said, that moves us on to the data structure point there. What tables are available? What IDs have we got? And what can we join on across these different tables? Clicks and impressions tables, you know, Google Ads and Campaign Manager data. What can we join and what's the relationship between them? And then finally, to the last point, the ID spaces. So yes, we've greater capability of joining across environments and across platforms than before. But I would be misleading if I said to you that there's no caveats to that. There are Google IDs available in certain platforms, so Google Ads and YouTube, and then DoubleClick IDs available on other platforms. And of course, there are ways to join across the two, you know, collecting additional variables and floodlight tags. But by no means does it solve all of our cross-device issues. And hopefully that answers the question from Dan, but do let us know if that didn't. Anything you wanted to add to that, Theo?
I think that's perfectly correct. It depends on what you're trying to do and to what level as well. So what ideas you have available is simply your limiting factor. Sometimes we can do cross-device, sometimes we can do cross-environment, sometimes cross-platform, but depending on what we're trying to do and how we're trying to do it. So.
Yeah, and that ties back to this point about what's the relationship between the tables, where are the IDs between the tables, and I put in the chat a link to the ADH schema earlier if you want to investigate that a little bit further. Question there from Balaji, I think I'm saying that name right, so I might just flip to this slide. What Google platform identifiers are similar? So as I mentioned, across ads and YouTube, you've got the Google account IDs, and then the products that can be tracked, Campaign Manager or sharing the DoubleClick ID. We've got device IDs as well. And if you're importing your first-party data, it depends then whether you're pushing that into floodlight variables as well, where that might also sit and be useful when the media, the ad tags are firing.
Dan put one we missed slightly off is multiple questions. Dan put, what level of effort to turn ADH on? I think for this one, it really depends on where your starting point is. If you have a pristine Campaign Manager set up across all your Google Marketing platforms, and you're just looking, and you're currently using DT files, and you're just looking to do a transfer from DT files to ADH, then it's a simple question of going to your Google representative and getting it set up with this, and they'll link it up, and there's some contracts and paperwork to deal with. If you are starting a bit more in a rudimentary position, and maybe your Campaign Manager is not quite set up correctly, or it's not in a good place, then there might be a lot more effort involved to turn ADH on. And it depends, when you say turn it on, it also depends on what you're trying to do with it as well, because just to get it to work doesn't mean, or to have an instance of ADH, doesn't mean you'll be able to use it the way you want to use it. So it really depends on what you're trying to do.
I think another point to add to that as well is you should ideally have a think about your data structure before you even integrate it into Ads Data Hub. So how are your advertisers structured? What's the quality of your campaign manager setup? If you really want to go way back just to make it easy for you to query it in the interface, you know, are we setting ourselves up for success in that point of view as well? And obviously that insight comes from somebody who's working with us internally from a media background, who's a strong advocate for considering your tech implementation and naming conventions and architecture design, if you have the opportunity to do so there. So we do have another question. So from Michael, we can use ADH pretty good as a sandbox to test and understand the process, and we don't need an Ads Data Hub instance. So on that, you'd need to follow up with your Google partner or your partner organization to understand how you can get access and whether you can get access to the sandbox then as well.
Yeah, so it depends on if you're client side or agency side. If you're agency side, you may get a something to link up for yourself for testing and things like that. If you're client side, it'll obviously be just for your data.
Mm-hmm. So reach out to your Google Partner Manager. All right, so if we don't have any more questions, then I have one or two more for Theo, actually, that I think you'll all benefit from. So from one trainer to another, as we said at the start, we've done quite extensive research asking people from the data engineering team, from the training team, from the analytics team, from, you know, from media planning side of things, their experience in learning Ads Data Hub. And so we wanted to share some of that with you. So what roles, client and agency side, find it the easiest to upskill on Ads Data Hub?
So I think for this one, to look at it, there's certain skill sets that are obviously required. You have the media buying side and the wealth of information from there. And then you have the technical side, which would be people who are skillful in SQL. Now, obviously, to learn SQL may take longer, but I come from the SQL side, or the learning SQL. I'm an analytics person. And so for me, learning the media buying side and what you do with ADH has been quite a struggle, I guess, because I haven't got that background per se. But when it came to learning how to use the tool, I was a little better equipped. However, from the media planning side, you're much better in position to actually think, how am I going to really benefit from this tool? How I might use it with my campaigns, my use cases, and future use cases as well. And so you don't necessarily need that SQL. To use the tool, you need the SQL skills, but to have that sort of how I'm going to use it, which I think is where the most value is going to come from, will be that media side. But they'll see if you want to get upskilled, then obviously you need to upskill yourself with SQL. One of the advantages, though, I guess, with ADH is there is a lot of template queries in ADH, and to do a few alterations is not too difficult. So to get some value out of it with little skill on SQL shouldn't be too difficult. But it's all about time and effort, I guess, these things. So it's a matter of hours you're willing to put into it. More hours gives you better results.
And ideally, a powerful team will combine people from both disciplines who will understand, you know, how to write the queries effectively and efficiently, but then also have folks on the team that understand the context of the data and what marketing are trying to achieve with it and how it's going to influence future media plans and indeed, you know, what format it needs to be in, what the audience size needs to be, et cetera, for us to activate in relevant platforms. We've seen people come at it from both angles. Those with SQL skills will run at it faster, but perhaps then reach a certain point where they need to spend more time developing their understanding of media buying to be able to really generate impactful insights. And then, you know, from the other side, as Theo said, from the media perspective, it can be more of a steep learning curve if you don't already have the SQL skills, but you will be able to articulate to your colleagues how this can be beneficial. Question two, what is the most common mistake that you see people make when they're learning to use Ads Data Hub? Yeah.
This one is, the main thing about Ads Data Hub is the privacy restrictions. So using the sandbox mode, you must use the sandbox mode, do your queries first, because if you have more and more people who are using ADH, the easier and easier it is to accidentally query the same data over and over again with very similar differences, which will then give you those privacy flags, not allowing you to access the data. And it's something to, like 6 months, I think the restrictions are, so you won't be able to access that data for about 6 months. So using the sandbox mode, and therefore also things like not using a temporary table as well, because then you can read that way, if you have a temporary table, that when you come back the next day, you can still query the same temporary table. You don't need to query again.
Up to
72 hours, exactly. So definitely using those temporary tables. And when you're doing manipulation of data, you can do the staging with temporary tables, and you don't have to output the data every time it's a big query at each stage. You can just keep it all in the ADH instance. So yeah, that's, I think, the key one, I guess.
I think also, I wouldn't say it's necessarily a mistake, but maybe a jarring point you mentioned earlier, is just that concept of having to look at two different platforms, one where you're putting in the query and then the results appearing somewhere else, and understanding that you will be working behind this veil initially, potentially, and getting used to the Azure Hub schema itself is beneficial, and what IDs are available to join across the spaces. It's a different experience.
Just one point, I guess, on the sandbox mode as well, is you actually can have a look at the data coming out of the end. So you don't necessarily, you can output the data to your BigQuery from sandbox unaggregated, but you'll get all the error messages. So you'll be fully aware that you're making a mistake, but you can do that to have a look at how the data is residing. So you have no idea how your data is going to reside in ADH, and how the data structure is going to look. So you can actually output some of the fields directly, like the user IDs or the activity IDs, directly from ADH sandbox. So do use that, and it can really help you get a look and feel for the thing, because you can't see your own data. It's behind that curtain or walled garden, if you like, but you can actually access the sandbox data. So.
Mm-hmm. And one last thing, those that are used to working with DT files might be used to exporting that data, taking it out and putting it into another platform for attribution. That's obviously not in accordance with the nature of Azure Hub and the whole concept around privacy. So that's not something that can be done. So without further ado, we're going to bring this session to a close. We're just 1 minute over. Theo and I are busy geeking out and didn't realize the time. But do feel free to pop any additional questions into the chat. We're happy to hang on a bit to answer those for you. And thank you for joining.